this last couple to come in.
Good afternoon. It's good to see everybody here. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, Father, for Tonya, Lord, everything that she's done and helped people along her way. Father, she was different, just like all are we. In your word, it says, we are peculiar people, Lord, and yes, we are. And I thank you for that, Father. Thank you for your spirit being here this morning, Lord. Guard and guide, Father, as we continue with this service, Father, and touch the hearts of each and every one. We ask all these things in your holy and precious name. Amen.
Amen.
I remember Tonya years ago. She was so much fun. She had a spirit about her, and she was so smart, but yet she would go have fun just like you and I do. Some of us had a little bit more fun than we should, but, you know, that's part of life and part of growing. I want to sing a song for you this morning, and it's, if that's okay with you. Nothing thrills the heart of man like passing through death's gate. Yet to him who enters daily death's so glorious fate, dearly beloved, we are gathered here to be a holy bride. And daily cross death's holds for the holy life inside. Enter in, surrender to the Spirit's call to die and enter in, find peace within. The holy life awaits you, enter in. If mourner should lament, then let them live for those who survive. If only when self-will is killed, can my soul survive. Enter in, surrender to the Spirit's call to die. And enter in, find peace within. The holy life awaits you, abundant life is waiting for you. The holy life awaits you. Enter in. Amen. In life, when we begin as a child, we enter the world not knowing anything, not knowing who we are or where we're going. You know, without the Lord in my life, I would have been so lost. Tonya learned when she started growing up, she knew exactly what she wanted to do. She loved people. She took care of people. And Tonya had a lot of compassion. She had a very big heart. This morning I want to minister with you for a few moments. It's in Ezekiel 37, 1 through 14. It says, God's breath suffocates death. And if you think about those words, death is a thing that we deal with. But it's also, God has the key to death. So when we pass, God takes us on to his heavenly place, to a glorified place with no pain. I can just see Tonya and Tara standing up there, just looking down, smiling. You know, and saying, we're home. They're at the last step. They're both home, and they know. Now, you know, a lot of times folks say, well, you know what? When you go to heaven, what happens? Well, you know, you're in glory land. You have no more pain, no more sickness, no more sorrows. It says, standing in a valley full of dry, dead human bones, no abstract, philosophical encounter with death. God has brought Ezekiel to his grim graveyard as the prophet balanced himself on broken skulls and rib bones. God took him by the hand, led him around as if to make sure he didn't miss a bone. Death filled all the senses of Ezekiel, surveyed the grim reaper's playground. It has been 10 years since Ezekiel, his family, and others had been marched off into exile from Judah. Babylon, which was his whole world and his whole culture, unraveled under the rule of Babylon. Life in a foreign region, he's cut off from native cultures. His religion and customs must have been lonely and hopeless. Yet Ezekiel's role as a prophet was to remind him, his people, that God was still in charge. You know, God was in charge. He planned all of this today. And, you know, he's watching us of what we do and how we do it. Tonya was a person that lived life to the fullest to me. She was wonderful, and she knew how to rule the roost when she needed to rule it, you know, and she, when she worked at the hospital, she was wonderful. People respected her, and people loved her. And there's a lot of things in life, we all make mistakes, right? We all make mistakes, and we have to learn from them. Sometimes it takes a little bit longer, and I'm one of them, to learn the hard way, where God will mold you and put you where you need to be. God's voice broke the silence, and he said, mortal, can these bones live? God was asking Ezekiel, can these bones live? You know, and Ezekiel, being human just like we are, he's thinking to himself, can bones actually live? Standing knee-deep in dry, white, bleached human bones, Ezekiel is asked this question, and we listen to the scriptures reading, there's an audible sense of empty nothingness. He just thought they were just bones. white and bland, canvas of despair. He was covered in colorless paints, fills a scene where there is death, there is nothing. There is no smell, no color, no movement, no breath in this place of hopelessness. He said, what faith it looked for Ezekiel to muster his answer. Oh, Lord God, you know. He was referring back to God. You know what the bones are. I think he was being a little turkey, I believe. But God tells Ezekiel to prophesy and tell the bones that God's breath will come into them. When God breathes his breath into you, you will know it. You will know God is there. And a lot of times we have to stop and wait. We're in so much of a hurry. But if we stop and wait for that small, still voice, he will never steal your own. Our flesh gets in the way. You know, we're human. The flesh gets in the way. But once the Spirit hits you, and he tells you what you need to do, it's said and done. All right. These brittle, dead bones will live and be covered by sinews and flesh. In response to God's living breath, Ezekiel hears a rattling noise as the bone is joined to bone. Next, God tells his prophet to call upon the four winds from where God's breath will come to bring these bones to life. All of this happened because God said, so Ezekiel dared to believe. God's breath suffocated death, took away death. The life-giving breath of God will even open the graves of the dead. God's breath suffocated death. So when Satan fell and went to hell, God took the key of death and the grave. So we don't have to worry. God's got it. He's got it covered. When we pass, you know, when the roll is called up under, he'll be there. And we should be there as well. He called on all four winds. God's breath will come to bring these bones to life and restore the people of Israel. All of this happened because God said so, and Ezekiel dared to believe. God's breath suffocated death. The life-giving breath of God will even open the graves of the dead. God's breath suffocated death. What could be more different from a valley full of dry dead bones to a human bones to a freshly stinking corpse of a man? Yet the result of death is the same, hopeless and despair. This is not the nation of Israel that grieves without hope, but to ordinary sisters, Mary and Martha. Their brothers Lazarus was sick, dying, when they sent word to Jesus, Lord, he whom you love is ill. Jesus did not arrive until 4 days after Lazarus had been put in the tomb. No wonder when Martha met Jesus, she told him that he had arrived sooner, her brother would have not died. For death seems so powerful and permanent when you find yourself hopelessly touched by the cold hand. Mary echoes her sister's same feelings when she meets Jesus too. Lord, if you had been there, my brother would not have died. Death has convinced the sisters that death is and there is no God. So right there, they didn't believe there was no God at all. Until he spoke the word, and the dry bones became flesh. I don't know about everybody in here, but I've seen many miracles in the last 30 to 40 years, in and out of ministry, and people having faith beyond to believe something can happen. And we had an instance where a young boy had come, and we were associate pastor of the Church of God here in Waycross. And the mama came. She knew that she wanted her son healed. He was deaf when he was born. He was 5 years old. She came into the church, and the Holy Spirit was moving. I mean, people were getting saved, set free. I mean, just all by listening to God and praying. That's how it happened. She came in, she said, God has already healed my son. So first of all, that takes a lot of faith. That takes a ton of faith for a lady you've never seen before to come in here. She said, God has already healed my son. Will you pray for him? And that instant, the preacher went back, but anyway, the boy all of a sudden turned his head and looked at his mama. And she knew right then that he was healed. He was set free. And at that moment, our church burst like it was filled with the Shekinah glory, the hallelujah. The Spirit of God was walking in there. And some people had come and had no idea. Walked in the sanctuary, got hit by the Spirit, got saved, set free, healed, delivered. I mean, I believe a lot of times Tonya had her personal walk in the hospital, especially. She had chances to go see people and pray for them without them even knowing it. And I do that all the time. I pray for people I have no idea who they are. But that's what we're supposed to do as Christians. Tonya was, you know, she had a ministry of her own. She was a blessing to other people. The scriptures are very clear and forceful that in time of crisis, many people feel the absence of God. This is pain and loss and brokenness and death. And all of our human beings get hurt and oftentimes struggle to sense life and death-filled world. God doesn't call us, drop by and pat us on the back and tell us everything is going to be okay. Ezekiel was really in exile and captivity, and his nation had been destroyed. Jesus was really late and did not arrive in time for the funeral. Some of the times in lives have looked over a valley of dry bones or waited anxiously for Jesus who had never arrived on time. Dry bones were never fulfilled. You pleaded, worked, struggled, and prayed for God's help and intervention, yet you still fell short. The dry bones may be a broken marriage. Things were so wonderful and romantic at your wedding, only become brittle and broken. Little by little, death began to consume your relationship. You called out for Jesus to come to you in counseling, prayers, honest, and church. But he was too late as you walked away from the lawyer's burial service. Or these dry bones could be a faith gone dead and hopeless. You watch your children die. For some horrible disease, your father turned into some kind of Alzheimer vegetable. Where is the hope in God as your child literally wastes away, or as you're young, as you change your father's diapers? Scriptures are very concrete in their understanding of the hopelessness of despair, but painful as many may be, healing begins when we take a long, hard look at our bones and our graves. For unless we acknowledge the dry bones of our lives and the stench of our powerful smell, There we will always be empty, rattling in our own souls as death laughs by way through of lives. But we as Christians proclaim the death has not won, and his laughter will be silenced by the power of hope. God's breath suffocates death. God has taken away the sting and the grave from death. So we don't have to worry about that anymore. I've seen many of funerals I've gone to and weddings where people are just sitting there, they're waiting to die. You know, and I tell them, it's not over yet. You're still living. You know, God has a purpose for you. It doesn't matter if you're paralytic. I've got a friend of mine that is, but he still works for a living. And he, you know, he's a wonderful guy, loves people. There was a song years ago that we sung. It's called Don't Give Up. God is on the way. There is a miracle in the making for you today. For each and every one of you that come today, there's a miracle for you. God has it ready for you. We've got to stand up. We've got to honor Tonya and the life that she lived. She was a wonderful lady. We need to stand up, you know, and own up to who we are and let people know, you know, hey, I'm a born-again Christian. God loves you. Don't beat up on people. Tonya was, I don't remember her ever doing that in her younger life at all. She'd go to work, be happy, and then come home. She had a lot of things to do, and it seemed like she was always staying busy. And that's what I liked about her. She was always doing something, staying busy, and touching people all over that hospital. All over the floor that she had. She had one floor. She managed the floor in the hospital. And I know she touched many a lives. But now she's in glory land. Anybody say amen? Hallelujah. She's in glory land. You know, there is a time to mourn. There's a time to cry. And there's also a time to rejoice. I'm going to take the rejoice even though I miss. I miss Tonya a lot, but I know that she's in a place that we're all going to be. We're going to be there one day. And glory land, she's jumping up and down going, yes, hallelujah. No more pain. No more, you know, Tonya likes cigarettes. No more having that habit. No more worrying about, you know, what's going to be next. She don't have to worry anymore. You know, and we don't either. Make sure, please, every day that you wake up, tell God, thank you for letting me live. Because, you know, God has a ministry for everybody in the back, in the middle, and up front. God is good all the time. In season and out of season. Especially when we're going through trials and tribulations. And I've learned just to sit and wait. And wait for God. And when he comes, the presence will just... It will overwhelm you. And he will change your carnal mind to what would be a supernatural mind, which is the mind of Christ. And once you stay on that road, God will, he'll take you wherever you want to go. Whatever your dreams are, if you're honest with him, he'll take you. Tonya's dream was to be a nurse. She went all the way. You know, Tonya could have gone all the way up to being a doctor. I had no doubt she was smart, very smart, but we're going to miss her so much. And give my condolences to the family And I thank you all for coming out.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind.
Today, Father, we thank you, Father, for Tonya. Lord, we miss her so dearly, Lord. I pray for your peace that passes all understanding to be with each and every one of us as we console the memories of Tonya. Father, I pray, Father, that you will guard and guide each and every one as they walk out in this world to be a witness, to love people regardless of what they've done to you, to take hope and have faith, Lord, that you will always be there in their lives, Father. We pray if there's anyone lost, Father, that you will save them and set them free. Hallelujah, Lord. Anybody that needs healing, Father, you know,